All right, so thank you very much to the organizers for the invitation, and I will say some words about my collaboration with Giorgio later on. And it's a pleasure for me to be here because this is an audience which is expert in universal mechanisms for breakdown of ergodicity. And what I want to present today is something which is to me very surprising, but when I first read about it, and then of course when you start learning about the topic, you see that actually this idea traces back to many years before. So what I'm going to tell you about it's a breakdown of statistical mechanics due to quantum effects. By statistical mechanics, I essentially here, I don't mean like the tools of statistical mechanics, I mean the breakdown of the ergodic hypothesis due to quantum effects. So the fact that we can study a system without solving exactly the dynamics, but just looking at partition function, this is the power of statistical mechanics, and it can lead to, has led to essentially probably half of our physical knowledge of the world.
Excuse me.
Yes.
I mean breakdown of classical statistical mechanics.
No, I mean breakdown of statistical mechanics, even quantum statistical mechanics. Okay, so the fact, I hope I will be more clear in the presentation. So this line of research, for those of you who have heard the word, is now called many-body localization, because it evolved understanding what happens to Anderson localization when you don't consider single particle problem, but you consider interaction between the particles. So historically, people thought that Anderson localization, though there is Anderson transition in disordered solids, the Anderson insulators exist. Actually, when you introduce interaction, when you consider interaction, this idea goes down the drain and shouldn't work. Okay, but then, almost 10 years ago now, 2006, some works actually revived the possibility, and in fact proved in some cases that we can actually have breakdown of ergodicity. Anderson localization survives for interacting system. Okay, but let me be quick. So I will loosely talk about the ergodic hypothesis and canonical distribution, and from this, I will take the unusual point of view of considering the ergodic hypothesis and Langevin forces on the same footing, and try to see in a semi-classical way what's going to happen to Langevin forces and why quantum corrections to Langevin forces can actually point exactly in the direction of breakdown of ergodicity. And then, although usually when we do calculations, we go exactly in the opposite directions. So we start from strong disorder and move back to small disorder. That's what we have under control in mathematics. So I will give you a Gedanken calculation, essentially, of the transitions. And then I will talk about many-body localization and the interaction between MBL and glassy phase in the sense of replica symmetry breaking. Okay, so statistical mechanics in a slide is essentially considering isolated system composed of many particles governed by, for example, Hamilton equation. This is an isolated system, keep in mind. So we should solve all these equations in a time t which is much larger than the typical time of the motion, and for all the particles. This is very complicated, okay, and it might require very huge accuracy and everything, there is chaos, things don't work. I mean, it's not an easy problem to solve. In fact, we never solved it, essentially, except for a few cases. Moreover, it's overkilling, because we don't need the position and velocities of all the particles in the system. When we have a system composed of 10 to the 23 particles, what we need are a few observables, like pressure, temperature, susceptibilities, these kind of things, magnetization, angular momentum. So there must be a way that the limit, and we know by experience that these variables are enough to describe our system. Okay? So by experience, we know that there must be some simplification when n goes to infinity. And in fact, if you are not interested in very short times, and in some sense we are able to cluster, we should be able to cluster initial conditions by the value of the initial pressure, or maybe just a field of pressures defined on, you know, 10 to the 6 particles at a time. So this leads to the concept of equilibrium values for physical observables, in which essentially we average over a large time some functions of P and Q. Okay? So typically these averages exist for all Hamiltonian motions, for example. And the ergodic hypothesis is that the measure, the equilibrium measure, is here I'm only considering the case in which energy is the only conserved quantity, is just a microcanonical distribution. Good. Oh, by the way, the Boltzmann definition was a little bit different. So the ergodic hypothesis in Boltzmann definition is the following thing. So he says, let's take phase space. Let's discretize it in little boxes of a given phase space volume. But this is only for computational purposes. And then I will define a motion ergodic if, so any Hamiltonian motion in a discretized phase space is a permutation. Okay, because it moves every point in a volume, conserves the volume, and every point in the volume is moved to univocally to another point in the volume. So it's a permutation. I will define ergodic motion as when this permutation is a single cycle permutation. So there aren't subsets of volumes which are permuted among themselves. Okay? So this was Boltzmann's definition of the ergodic hypothesis. So once we have the microcanonical distribution, we can ask, for example, if we take a small subsystems of a larger system, what's going to happen to this? What's the induced measure on this small subsystem? This can be separated by space or by, we only consider every 100 particles. So, and as we all know, you know, from basic statistical mechanics classes, that if I now integrate the microcanonical distribution on nr out of n of these things here, of variables here, then what I get is the canonical distribution. So the canonical distribution comes from the ergodic hypothesis. Okay, now let's switch gears for a second. Let's talk about something else. Let's talk about Langevin forces. Now, if I take this small system here, and I say, okay, so now this small system is not isolated anymore, it's part of a big system, and what's the influence of the big system on the small system? Such that the equilibrium distribution on the small system is the same as induced for the microcanonical, from the microcanonical distribution. Well, it's not difficult to see that if I consider the Ito equations, this is now variables only on the subsystems, and I add a term which gives energy, which is the diffusion constant, and a term which takes energy out, which is friction. And then I take this equation here, and I write the Fokker-Planck equation for the probability distribution. And then this Fokker-Planck equation has a unique stationary solution, which is e to the minus beta hs, where hs is h of the subsystems only. Okay? And one interesting point is actually that the temperature depends only on the ratio between gamma and d. It's actually the ratio between gamma and d. So I can take at the same time gamma and d going to infinity and obtain the same equilibrium distribution by rescaling the time. This is, for example, when Jorge showed the Langevin equations. I mean, typically people do this, and if you do this, you forget completely about the momentum, and you only look at this part of the equation, essentially, setting this is equal to zero. And so you have one less. I mean, you lose one order in the differential equation, but the stationary solution is the same. Of course, the stationary solution is not the only interesting thing. As Jorge was showing us yesterday, if you look at metastable states, are states which, you know, have an eigenvalue of this part properly symmetrized of the Fokker-Planck equation, which is not zero. So, a subsystem is in equilibrium, in some sense, with the, it's you know, we can consider a subsystem as being in equilibrium with the bath if the influence of the rest of the system on the subsystem is given by Langevin forces. In some sense, this is a sufficient condition, certainly probably not necessary. But once this is true, all of statistical mechanics follows. So we just need to compute partition functions, just, quote unquote. Okay. And of course, all of thermodynamics follows. So in particular, two systems posing contact with reach thermal equilibrium. So Giorgio has showed us, in his career, together with his collaborators, a way of breaking down of ergodicity, even if we have these Langevin forces, okay? So in the thermodynamic limit, Langevin forces doesn't mean that you reach ergodicity. And there is a very specific way in which this doesn't happen. What I want to show you today is that quantum mechanical effect can lead to another kind of ergodicity breaking, in which the number of states can be as big as the number of configurations in the system. Okay, so let's try to think a little bit without doing calculations. So what can be the quantum effects on Langevin forces? So Langevin forces must have a continuous spectrum. This we know. If I do a Fourier transform, typically actually Langevin forces, we think about white noise. Okay, so this is certainly a continuous spectrum. And in the semi-classical approximation, we can think of a spectrum of forces start developing oscillations on top of a smooth classical part, as it happens, for example, for the density of states. So if you ever did a calculation in quantum mechanics on density of state of a system, in semi-classical approximation, you have the density of state given by the essentially microcanonical distribution. And then on top of that, you have to add contribution from closed orbits, and then contribution from more and more closed orbits. And this, in a semi-classical approximation, is called the Wurtz-Wheeler formula, but you know, many people have done this. So you see, quantum mechanics is making this spectrum less smooth. So it's moving in direction against ergodicity. Eventually, it could be that strong quantum effects can change completely the nature of the spectrum from absolutely continuous to pure point. These are mathematical definitions of the spectrum, of local density of states. Okay. Single particle problems, this spectrum is given by, these are eigenstates of energy omega, and the x is the position ket. In many body systems, you have to look at spectra of local operators. And indeed, they go from continuous. So when I change a parameter, for example, this order, which increases the number of closed orbits. So if I have this order in my system, the particle can not only go ballistically in one direction, but it can actually scatter and come back. And this adds some oscillations. And when there is a lot of disorder, there is a lot of closed paths. And this actually adds more and more and more oscillations. Okay. When increase the disorder in my system, one can actually have a transition. The Anderson transition is transition in which the local density of state goes from absolutely continuous to pure point. The many-body localization transition is the transition in which a spectrum of local operators go from being continuous to being pure point. Okay, let me give you an example. Now, there is something, so when we, in fact, if you take the Anderson model is hopping, I don't have it here, so let me just write. You have a lattice. There is hopping amplitude, usually minus t, and there is energy on site, epsilon I. So the Hamiltonian is minus t sum over the edges of the lattice of hopping on the lattice, and then there is an on-site energy. This is a quadratic Hamiltonian in creation and annihilation operators, and therefore it's a free particle. So, so these epsilon i's are random numbers which come from a distribution, let's say, which has some support, minus w half, uniform, but the support of the distribution, I mean, the specific form of the distribution does not matter. So when we don't have any disorder, so this term is zero, we have the band structure of the lattice. When we add disorder and we increase the disorder very much, this band structure of delocalized states gives room to instead a spectrum of localized states. You don't have transport anymore, and that's it. Ergodicity goes out of the drain. Okay, mathematically speaking, we were able to, mathematical physicists, Michael Eisenman and other people, were able to prove that for large disorder, the spectrum is pure point. But nobody was ever able to prove that for small disorder, the spectrum is absolutely continuous. So, in some sense, what I showed before is a Gedanken calculation in which we start from the other point and show that there is absolutely continuous spectrum and then dies, becomes pure point. I don't know how to do that calculation. Nobody knows, actually. Okay, so let's start from large disorder or from small j. So let's consider this Hamiltonian. In this Hamiltonian, we have spin 1 half. Actually, spin s. I generalized to spin s in this case. And j essentially, so this is Heisenberg interaction, is sx, sx, plus sy, sy, plus sz, sz, that we can write as s plus s minus, s plus sz, sz. Now, the plus minus term reduces the spin here and increases the spin here. And test coupling J. If there is no coupling J, or if you can think if the disorder H goes to infinity, then the states in which each of these spins has a specific SZ value of SZ, that's an eigenstate. Then we increase J, and these eigenstates have to start mixing, in which a particle here a spin here can change its value, and at the same time, the spin here can change its value, and then at order j square, also this one here can change its value, and so on and so forth. So what is important? Well, in amplitudes, in quantum mechanics, what we have is the transition amplitude, so the coupling, the matrix element, divided by the energy difference. In particular, if I can move this spin up and this spin down, paying very little energy, less than J, then this is going to happen. And these two spins are in resonance. This is going to happen. And if this keeps happening along my chain, I can transport spin from one side of the chain to the other. Okay? Mathematically speaking, what we do is while we keep adding order by order in J to our perturbation theory, my spectrum, which was pure point, starts filling in and might become absolutely continuous. So what I have to look at is the radius of convergence of perturbation theory made with random coefficients, because let me remind you that these H are random, okay? This is a heck of a calculation to do, but we were able to do it. We were not the first one, because the first paper that actually started this was by Basco, Lehner, and Schuller, and with Markus Müller and Valentina Ross sitting here in the audience, we were able to show to redo those calculations in a different way, in a different setup, and show that this, when that perturbation theory converges, there are integrals of motion in the system, but this I will tell you before. But morally, if you swipe all the math under the rug, the only thing that remains is that essentially we have to look at a series which is something like J over H divided by S, which is the difference of energies in the denominator, to the n. Okay? So this kind of series, it's a kind of geometric series in some sense. The coefficients here don't grow faster than an exponential. And this was, we had to prove this actually. And gives a critical value for J over H, for which this series can be convergent or not. Okay? And gives J over H over S, which is some order one. So for J divided H over S less than order one, let's say this K is 6. Okay. For J less than this, then there is no transport. The spectrum is pure point. For J larger than this, the spectrum is continuous. There is transport. Localization to delocalization transition. So what does an MBL spin system look like? Energy charge and spin transport is suppressed. Some memory of the initial state is conserved forever in local quantities, which are called local integrals of motion. Eigenstates have very low entanglement, even at high temperature. Entanglement of an initial product state grows slowly up to an extensive value. Eigenstates closing energy have different footprints of local observables. This was very surprising to researchers in the field, because area low entanglement has always been associated with ground states. And as soon as you go up to finite temperature, essentially statistical mechanics tells you that you must have a volume term in the entropy, in the entanglement entropy, because there is a statistical part of the entanglement entropy. The entanglement entropy has to reduce to the entropy of the system, of the subsystem, when you know, we go to the classical limit. This is an extreme form of glassiness in which every eigenstate is its own cluster. Okay, so the link, if you want, with the physics of glasses is somewhere here. Although this is like pushing to the limit in which every cluster is a single configuration, quote unquote. It's not a configuration, it's an entangled state. Okay. And now I have a video here. So this is the case in which we have small disorder, and J is larger than this JC. So this is the Hamiltonian, and this is the numerics with it. This is the initial state. This is the energy density, So the energy density is essentially, you take the Hamiltonian, you break it into local terms, and, or you have to do it in an appropriate way in order. And then you compute the expectation value of these local terms on the quantum state, which is evolving in time. So let me show you what happens with small disorder. That you start with this, and then, you know, the energy equilibrates. I put more energy in the left than in the right, and the system is going to go to equilibrium. And this goes on for another minute and five seconds, and let me assure you that nothing happens. I mean, once you reach equilibrium, there are fluctuations and so on and so forth. If you're thinking about Poincaré recurrence time, that scales like 2 to the L here, and L here is 14, and you know that doesn't happen. So this will just keep oscillating and staying there. Okay. And this is a result of a numerical computation in which we did exact time evolution of the state. Okay? Now, what happens if we have large disorder? We start again with a state in which we put a lot of energy here and very little energy here. And it does not equilibrate. Just oscillates around like this, over and over. If you're wondering if this ever actually goes to equilibrium, it does not, because we looked at the eigenstates. You can take, in quantum mechanics, if you take the large time average, you can do it explicitly and get the diagonal ensemble. So if you look at the eigenstates, you're really looking at the infinite time average, and the eigenstates will tell you that this doesn't go to equilibrium. So this is what I'm talking about. It's like putting all the particles in this part of the room and then let it evolve, and typically they will spread and the density will be more or less constant everywhere. But in this kind of Hamiltonians, this doesn't happen. You put all the particles there and then they move a little bit and then they stay there. Okay, or, you know, I put fire here on this part of the handrail and that part over there never becomes hot. So this is what we are talking about. This is why I'm saying that statistical mechanics breaks down. Thermodynamics breaks down in the sense that the zeroth law of thermodynamics, if I put two systems in contact, they will reach thermal equilibrium, does not apply. Okay. So on the mathematics side, we can prove that for large disorder, this Hamiltonian can be rewritten as this Hamiltonian, okay, in which the IA are now epsilon A, CAB, CABC, there should be a C here, sorry, CABC and so on and so forth, are terms which depend functionally on J and HI, but in a complicated way. And these IA are local commuting operators. They have to be both local and commuting. If they are non-local, you can do this for any Hamiltonian. Think about the projectors. If they are non-commuting, then why do you look at them? I mean, you cannot specify them. They're not good quantum numbers. So with a set of local commuting operators, what does local means? That if you take any operator, on a site C, the norm of the commutator of the operator OC with IA is exponentially decaying with the distance between the site A and the site C. So IA really describes something which happens close to a neighborhood A. If you write this Hamiltonian, you get exactly all the things that I said before. Area of entanglement, spreading of entanglement of initial states, which are not eigenstates. Of course, memory of initial states remains forever because it's just these quantum numbers. These are conserved. They commute with themselves, therefore they commute with the Hamiltonian, so on and so forth. Okay, so in spin glasses, if you have a cluster, intra-cluster dynamics is diffusive. The dynamics between clusters is the problem. Okay, that's activated dynamics. It becomes very, very complex. Here, what I'm saying here is that essentially, what I said before, I'm just repeating it, each eigenstate is its own cluster. Even inside the cluster, there is no diffusive dynamics ever. And this is due to the fact that there are no Langevin forces. Okay, so there is no way we can actually approximate a local, a local motion with expanding, something which is doing a Brownian motion inside a potential which is quadratic, maybe if you're close to a minimum, so on and so forth. Okay. Right. So now let me be a little bit more specific with models. Let me consider what happens to the P-spin model endowed with quantum dynamics. Okay, so this is the P-spin model. Let's take the P going to infinity limit to begin with, and we have the random energy model. The random energy model has a glass paramagnetic transition at TC. So what I want to do is to endow the system with the quantum dynamics. So I take the Hamiltonian with sigma z, and I add the term which is non-commuting. Now, there are two things that we can look at: the thermodynamic phase diagram and the existence of a localized phase. Let me stress that these are two independent questions. We can always compute the partition function of this system, even if it turns out that this is localized, because we say we couple it to a bath. If we couple it to a bath, we destroy localization. Localization is a question about isolated systems. Okay, so in the random energy model, when we send P to infinity, as you know, this was discussed yesterday by Giulio, these become just independent Gaussian numbers, variables. The dynamics of the system is always activated. Why? Because, as Giulio said yesterday, you take a state, any state at temperature T, this has energy which is different. Let's say the energy of the typical state is zero. Okay? Then any state at finite temperature has an energy which is order n below zero. You make a spin flip, you go to a completely random state. This completely random state with probability 1 is in the middle of the spectrum, has energy order square root of n. So there is a different, there is a jump of n minus square root of n. So the dynamics must be always activated, otherwise you don't ever get, you always reject your Monte Carlo move. Okay, so the thermodynamics of this model was done by Goldschmidt in the 90s, and then there is another paper which is very relevant by Orge Kurchan, Jorg, and Florian Krasala, and well, somebody else. I think there is a fourth name. In 2008, in which they redo, in particular in view of, I think you were thinking about the adiabatic algorithm. Yeah, so the thermodynamic is the following thing. So there is a phase transition. So this is the classical line. And more or less any dynamics you give to the classical system, which is not the quantum dynamics, so gamma equals zero, will see this thermodynamics here. If you endow it with the quantum gamma, then you go to a phase transition. Now, if you ask the question about the dynamics of this system, you get these, you get to superimpose another line which signals the many-body localization, delocalization transition. In particular, at small gamma, the quantum dynamics is ineffective, and the states are many-body localized. Now, for this particular model, the random energy model, each state is its own cluster. So the quantum dynamics and the classical dynamics coincide. Okay, this is not going to be true if we have P finite, as I will show you. But what's interesting is that there is a transition, and the quantum dynamics of the random energy model becomes ergodic for gamma sufficiently large. So this light blue region here is ergodic. And as you can see, it has both a quantum paramagnet and a classical paramagnet part. And the classical glass part is screened by the transition. So we don't have a classical ergodic classical quantum ergodic glass. So what does it mean to look for this transition? So for example, one can look at various things. One of the things is the level statistics. If level statistics is Wigner-Dyson, we typically, we associate this with ergodicity. If it's Poisson, we associate it with localized states, integrable systems, quote unquote. And you can see by increasing system sizes that there is a transition here. This part up here is Wigner-Dyson for this indicator, which is an indicator based on the ratio of the adjacent gaps in the eigenstates, eigenvalues. So this goes towards Wigner-Dyson for sufficiently large energy density. You see here the infinite temperature is zero, and this is close to the ground state. And this is the same thing when you fix the energy density, you change gamma. We did some analytical calculations. We actually reproduced the thing in the analytical calculation. The thing to compute is the probability amplitude of going. So this is the space of configuration. It's an hypercube of four spins. We want to go from an initial state, which is initial spin configuration in SZ, to a faraway state, which is a configuration of in which, for example, all the spins are flipped. And you have to compute the amplitude. And the interesting point is that the amplitude is the coherent sum, being an isolated system, it's coherent sum of all these paths that lead from I to F. And this in perturbation theory, this is the product along the path that you have to take. And you have to compute the probability that this amplitude decays exponentially. If this does, then the system is localized. Now, you can actually compute this probability and show this is the exponential of an exponential. This, in the exponent of the exponent, there is this function f. If this function f is always negative, then we have a localized state. If this function f becomes positive, x is the distance from the initial position, Hamming distance from the initial position divided by the number of spins. And this function x is, function f is something and gives this critical line here, which essentially superposes to this line here. Okay? By the way, here I'm talking about temperature, but it's just the Lagrange multiplier of the energy. I'm not really considering coupling the system to bath. So if you want, here, from the quantum mechanical point of view, there is no temperature. It doesn't make sense to define. Well, in some sense, as I say, this is good news, because classical dynamics is never ergodic. It is always activated. So for this model. So the fact that the quantum dynamics is a surprise, although we were looking for the opposite, for the other thing. OK, now let me, in the interest of time, let me go quickly. So on for P, for the P-spin model, that this line, the line that went on forever in the random energy model actually terminates. And if the line terminates, then there is no symmetry distinguishing the two sides of the line. And we cannot talk of classical quantum paramagnet. We can only talk of paramagnet. Because you can just go around this point here, so there is no symmetry breaking. And the glass is there. And there is this T star temperature around which this thing kind of happened, which is square root of P divided by 4 log P. We can redo the same computations. Now, the dynamics is not necessarily only activated, because if I take a state and I flip a spin, I get order P energy away. P is large, but it's order 1. It's not order n. Okay. Again, we can do this calculation, despite the fact that now the energies are correlated, because the system remembers where it started when you op on the hypercube. Not like the random energy model, in which the energies on the configuration is completely uncorrelated. And you can get this function, f, which is a bit complicated also in terms of this integral, which we're not able to express analytically. And this function f has a very similar form as the one before, in which it's always negative, modulo one thing that I'm going to tell you. It's always negative. And then at a certain point, it becomes positive. And therefore, there is the probability to jump to a faraway site is non-zero. It's actually 1. Now, the little modulo is that if you really go and focus on a region which is a side 1 over p in Hamming distance, the function f is always positive. So this is just the indication that there is a cluster. There is a cluster of Hamming distance, of Hamming radius, 1 over p. So there are 2 to the n over p states in a cluster around a given state, which hybridize because this function is positive. But then the different clusters are but then, for example, take the blue curve, then if you go further away the distance 1 over p, then the system doesn't go there, doesn't want to hybridize with those states over there. So this is a picture of clusters, which is the picture, yes?
This is even in the paramagnetic
localized paramagnetic
phase. No, in the localized, no, there is no localized paramagnetic phase here. Because if you go, no, sorry. So there is this T star. So in the T star, for T less than T star, there is a critical gamma after which this happens. For T larger than T star, there is no localized paramagnetic phase. So the diagram is this. There is a non-ergodic phase and an ergodic, which I wrote ETH because I took this from, I mean, we were ETH, eigenstate thermalization hypothesis, is the technical way in which people discuss ergodicity in quantum mechanics. Yes. So up to T star, which is, let me remind you, square root of P divided by 4 log P, you can have a non-ergodic region, and you can have an ergodic region, after which there is always ergodic region. Quantum dynamics fills the classical clustering and ergodicity breaking, but strictly speaking, there is no MBL, because there is always this little region here with the, where F is positive. That shouldn't be there for MBL. If you look, just one last slide, if you look at the spin glass on the beta lattice, this is a work that I did with my former student Gianni Mossi, what you see is the opposite. So there is a localized glass, the glassy region is larger than the localized region. So there is an ergodic region from the point of view of quantum mechanics. We haven't studied the clustering tra cluster transition, just talking about the cluster, in which there is a localized glass and a delocalized glass and a delocalized paramagnet. This line actually shrinks down to here. And so just to, you know, the message is that ergodicity breaking can come in different flavors for different dynamical rules. If you consider quantum mechanics as a dynamical rule, it's actually a completely different paradigm, so it's not surprising it comes in different flavor. And studying the interplay between them is actually helps shedding light on the universality characters of each of these phenomena. And implication of ergodicity breaking are as important in quantum mechanics as they are in classical mechanics, and they are very important in classical mechanics, as the work of essentially all of you has shown, led by Giorgio. So thanks again, and happy birthday, Giorgio.
Questions or remarks, please?
Well, I would like to make a comment on many body localization, and please Antonello could check if I'm saying right. I mean, I think that one of the main reasons for usually classical mechanics is ergodic goes back to, I think, a theorem by Poincaré that says that you start from some integrable system and you do a perturbation of the Hamiltonian, you don't have an analytic expression for integral motion.
Okay. Also, the first paper by Fermi is on
that. Also, exactly. Fermi was on that.
Yes, yes.
Now, this one, technically, when you look to the proof of Poincaré, you find that all the problem comes from the problem small denominator, which pile up and destroy analyticity. Now, the point that I think that was realized by in this many body localization, that this Poincaré theorem fail in the quantum case because small denominators are less dangerous than exactly. In the classical one, they're more benign, and therefore they pile up, but they do not destroy analyticity,
yes.
And therefore you can write explicitly integral motion also in the perturbed case.
Yes, that is exactly right, and this is exactly what we did in the paper with Valentina and Marcus. We went and built essentially Poincaré perturbation theory by using commutators instead of Poisson brackets, and looked at whether this series, which essentially contains small denominators, the probability to have a denominator so small to kill the radius of convergence of probability, actually this probability can be one or zero. So while in classical mechanics, the variable underneath are continuous. So there is always, if you move your canonical variables in a region, you will always find a denominator which is small enough. This is not true for a small number of particles, as the KAM theorem says. But if you go up to 6, 7, 8 particles, this always happens. So in quantum mechanics, the fact that the denominators come from quantized actions reduces the probability to have a resonance, and therefore can give you a convergent series. This is exactly right, yes.
We all know that the KAM theorem is irrelevant for more than 3 degrees of freedom.
Yes.
But could it be possible that in one dimension, in some classical spin system of one dimension, for reasons similar to this, there would be a KAM region even in the thermodynamic limit?
I doubt. So one dimension, you can think about, Fermi-Pasta-Ulam.
That example.
but something like that, in which you change the potentials.
Yeah.
I think the consensus is that essentially the system is going to be ergodic, in the sense that there's going to be going to equilibrium to a time length which can be really, really large. But even, for example, if you have diffusion, you create a packet here, okay, you let it evolve. The time for which the system goes to equilibrium scales like the system size, because it's the time for which this packet goes there. So these times to which you go to equilibrium can change scale like the system volume. So I think effectively that there might be some classical models in which you go to equilibrium to a very, very large time, but not localization. That.
Yes. Perhaps what Giorgio said about analyticity is a fundamental point, because we have KM Torrey notwithstanding non-analyticity. So probably classical mechanics says more than usually believed, because there are more possibilities.
Yes.
And I have the impression that we are unable at the moment to do a real correct statistical mechanics in presence of these situations.
Yes. Where
quantum mechanics seems to be a good, fantastic way to work with analytic things in a simpler way. Okay.
Because you quantize them in some sense, and then you don't have to.
It's a trick.
Yes. But as you see here, the classical. Just one last comment. I remember why I put this spin S thing, because the classical limit is S that goes to infinity. Right. That's a classical limit. It's a spin becomes continuous. So do you have a continuous particle? So the classical limit, you have the spin that goes to infinity, and you see that this always diverges. So localization is a quantum phenomena. It disappears when you send H bar to infinity or you take local things. But KM Torrey, they are a different thing. They are not localization. They are a different animal.
Okay, so let's
there is maybe we have time.
Well.
You are the chairman. So
there is a choice between coffee and the question.
Okay, then a quick and energizing question will make the role of coffee.
Just a quick question. So in the slide you show before, you was showing the XXX plus a disorder. So which is in terms of fermions is a strongly interacting system. So what happens if you have XX plus disorder? You have the same picture, or
XX plus disorder is that thing. And so it's localized in one dimension. No, and you don't have delocalization. You always have localization. Okay, now I think we should stop.
Okay, so let's thank you again.